recent story would be that as she approached a nice age, I won't give it, she began volunteering at the Long Creek Juvenile Detention Facility in Maine. And in so doing, discovered that her events of her young life over 35 years ago were still pretty current. That the story was being repeated, repeated, and repeated. And so it was time to do something. Catherine uses her story to educate and motivate. Catherine is originally from Winthrop, Mass., but she has very strong connections to Maine and has spoken at many Rotary Clubs. I'd like you to give her a warm welcome. Our speaker is Catherine Mossman.
Bear with me, I'm the IT guy.
He's the clucker. They said just do the Roxbury thing every time I'm on the stage. I am so honored to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me. I know that you invited me because you care about this issue, you're confused about this issue, and you'd like to know, is it really happening in the United States? Is it really happening in New England? What exactly is it? Where does it come from? You know, so many questions. So I'm going to try to answer as many as I can in 25 minutes. So I've been asked a lot, what in the world is sex trafficking? What is that? Who came up with it? I don't know who came up with that term, and it is confusing. It doesn't make sense. So I give my terminology. In 2000, when we have the Protection Act, it's the recruitment, harboring, transportation, provision, obtaining, patronizing. That's crazy. What it is prostituting or trading sex with a minor. So a third person manipulates or coerces, however, another person under the age of 18 and trades them for some sort of gain sexually. Sometimes they're traded for rent. Sometimes somebody will be traded for drugs. I mean, it doesn't have to be cash. It doesn't have anything to do with driving somebody over a state line. It can be just in one place. It's almost always Maine residents or United States residents. It's not a foreign thing, it's a people thing. Okay. So to understand sex trafficking, it helps to know where it comes from. And so I don't want to confuse you, I want to put all the pieces together. So if sex trafficking is over here, where does it come from? It comes from most cases, over 85% of the time, it comes from someone, a human being, being vulnerable to be manipulated in the first place. It has nothing to do with poverty or race or whether you're Bernie Sanders or Trump. It has to do with opportunity. So the opportunistic pimp is going to take a human being who is vulnerable to be manipulated. And that's how they, you know, they manipulate. But the people who are easily manipulatable are people who have most of the time, 85% of the time, been sexually abused in the past as a child. Not so you're not fabulous. So 50% of the people who call into the different programs were experienced sexual traffic before the age of 18. I'm just gonna throw some stats at you. No, please stay. Once I start going, you'll have to. So when I talk to my friends at Homeland Security, I say, how can I explain to people why sex trafficking is really grooming? So child sexual assault is as old as time. That is just sort of a standard. It's awful. It's always been awful. It's just awful. The reason why we're getting so much attention on it right now is because sex trafficking, the prostitution of minors, is really growing. The reason why it's really growing is because it's a moneymaker. So when I talked to Peter DiMaggio at Homeland Security, he said, give them this. 2015, take the annual income of Nike, Starbucks, and Google combined is how much money was profited on sex trafficking in the United States in 2015. It's about money. So the top three things that are spent in the United States, what is it, drugs and guns, sex trafficking has taken that seat as with drugs on the top three things that are make the most amount of money in the state in the United States. So people will tell me, well, where are predators? And I say, look around the room and tell me who is the heterosexual in the room. That's what predators look like. They look like everybody else. And where are they? They're absolutely everywhere. And people will say, well, you know, I feel really comfortable because I got on Maine.gov or NewHampshire.gov, and I know who the predators are in my neighborhood. And I say, well, that's good to know. You now know where the stupid ones are, because the smart ones are still out there. You look really cute there, you stay. So I've just given you a bunch of stats. And so over the past, Stop Trafficking Me has been official for a year. I've been doing this for almost 3 years, and I've learned so much. I'm a part of the York County Coalition Against Sex Trafficking, the Greater Portland Coalition Against Sex Trafficking. I work with the U.S. Attorney's Office. And there's no way it takes me 2 days to fill in everything that I've learned about this area and this issue, but I want to give you the preschool sort of 101 on it. So I thought, okay, 25 minutes. What can I do? What if I only had, you know, in those network things they say, do an elevator speech. So if I only had like 5 seconds, what would I tell you? Stop having sex with children. Kind of a no-brainer, isn't it? You would think, that's of course. If I had 1 minute, I would tell you why we shouldn't have sex with our children. When I talk to people that I respect, Homeland Security, FBI, U.S. Attorney's Office, cancer is awful, MS is awful, Parkinson's is awful, polio is awful. The single worst thing that we're dealing with in the entire globe is child sexual assault. That is the genesis of so many things. And I'm passionate about showing how that one thing creates so many other things that really haven't put all the pieces together yet, and I intend to put those pieces together for you. Okay, so when a child, so let's take all these different social ills. We'll take a child who's doing bad in school. We have somebody who's skipping school all the time, and we have somebody that drops out of school. We have drugs and alcohol. We have kids who are bullied. We have kids who are incarcerated. I volunteer at Long Creek Juvenile Detention Center on the girls' unit every Thursday. So we have all these different boxes. And from a society perspective, we say, oh, those are troubled kids, or those kids are troubled. We don't necessarily put the pieces together until we open the box on each of those issues and we look inside, and we see that over 85% of the time, those kids that are in those boxes were first sexually abused as kids. It is the genesis of so many things. There wouldn't be sex trafficking if these kids hadn't already been abused. So I like to use what makes me unique in being able to talk about this. There are plenty of advocacy groups out there that are doing good work. And the reason why I want to talk about it is because I'm an example of this list here. If you've ever watched Forrest Gump, by the way, Jenny is also a perfect example of that whole thing happening. Rewatch Forrest Gump and you're going to go, oh my God, I can't believe it. Anyway. So for me, my mom and dad were happily married. I'm the eldest of three kids. And my brother was very sick with asthma, and back then, again, I'm 52, so back then the asthma medicine wasn't as good as it is now. He was like, the doctor was saying, come and say goodbye to your son, he's not going to make it through the night. So he was a very sick kid. We went to Florida in the wintertime, and in the summer we owned and operated a cottage rental on Kenny Bunk Pond. So, for, you know, middle-income family, you know, my parents weren't drinkers or druggers, we were middle-income, happily married. And I was at the perfect place to be abused. So my first abuser was the vice principal of my school. He would take me out of class, bring me into his office, and sexually assault me. Now, I didn't tell my mom and dad, and I don't remember what he said for me not to say something, but I started having nightmares, awful nightmares. I started wetting the bed, but I was the first kid, so they would ask the doctor, you know, what's going on, and they said, oh, it's just typical kid behavior. It wasn't a red flag for them, even though the principal's, vice principal's calling me a special little girl. So as it is, and who knows why, actually Harvard has done research on this, and I don't know if it's a pheromone or what it is, but once a kid has been molested, it's typical for them to be re-victimized. And I was. I was re-victimized by my babysitter. I was bullied at school because now I'm acting different. I'm withdrawn. Who wants to have a bedwetter spend the night? Nobody. So now I'm bullied at school, but the boys would give me attention. The girls wouldn't give me attention. The girls were mean. So now I'm promiscuous. So now I'm, you know, just sort of sliding downhill. I'm really not doing drugs and alcohol, but I'm promiscuous, I'm skipping school, I'm a troubled kid. Now I'm running away. And I'm running away to my friend's house. Well, when you go to your friend's house, if those parents aren't calling your parents or calling the authorities, it's most likely that you've just gone from the frying pan into the fire. And I had. Now it's my friend's father molesting me, my friend's big brother molesting me. So now it's not okay to stay at people's houses. So now I'm going to stay in abandoned forts. I'm going to break into apartment buildings that are under construction. I got arrested for stealing a towel so that I can take a shower in one of the places that I had broken into. Now I have a record. So now I'm from 12 to 17 years old. I'm a runaway, more on the street than off the street. So I have to, you know, hurry along with this, but so I was raped a few times. I was picked up by my throat and choked to unconsciousness because some woman, drunk woman, thought that I was having sex with somebody in her family, and I was, so she tried to kill me. And when I wake up, all I can think of was, what nice thing can I say to her so she doesn't finish the job, you know? So at 15, I'm on Pike Street in Biddeford, and if you're familiar with Biddeford, you know that's an awful area. So I ended up in Biddeford, and I'm in an awful place. I'm in a terrible apartment building, and I see a couple of girls who have their own apartment building. So I'm 112, 15 pounds now, and then I was, you know, 80 something pounds. I wasn't menstruating because I didn't have enough nutrition in me to actually have a period. So I'm size zero. I'm 80 something pounds, I'm 15 years old, and I see these two girls who have their own apartment, and they look like they've got clothes and they've got their own apartment, and that's what I want. And they fed me macaroni and cheese with tuna fish and peas, and every time I say that, I can taste it. I could actually feel like the food going into my bloodstream. It was just like, oh, food, you know? And they said, hey, why don't you work for our boyfriends? We've got a couple guys, and you know, you could have your own apartment, and you could have clothes. And then I went back to where I was staying, and was raped by the guy that was living there, brutally. And then that morning, as soon as he left, I went to their apartment and said, sign me up, who do I talk to? And it's interesting, when you look back in life, and you see all the different crossroads that happen, and how God would intervene. The two men that I met with, one was black, one was white, they were known as Salt and Pepper. So the salt guy, the white guy, he was really weird looking. He had thick glasses, a really thin mustache, and one eye went way to the right. And the black guy was handsome and charming and very gregarious. And you would have thought I would have chose the black guy, but something inside said, choose the white guy. And I did, and good thing, because the black guy was like the kingpin for a whole underground child pornography and bestiality pornography ring that was going on. And when you did not obey him, not only would he break arms, never touch the face, but he would send bad girls to Lowell, Massachusetts, where the porno house was, and awful things happened there on the few girls that came back to tell us what happened. But I chose the white guy, and the white guy was a pimp wannabe. So he was learning from the black guy how to be a pimp, and he didn't have very many girls. I was one of them. Once you say yes, man, that's it. And I don't even know what would happen if you said no. I don't even know if no would be a choice, but I said yes.